Welcome back to Books with Burt. I'm Burt Folsom. In our last session of Books with Burt, we learned about America's first transcontinental railroad. Today, we will look at the life of a free market entrepreneur who built another transcontinental railroad, and he did it successfully without federal subsidies. This entrepreneur was James J. Hill. James J. Hill overcame an impoverished childhood. He was born in a log cabin in Ontario, Canada in 1838. Tragedy struck when his father died, and then young James lost use of his right eye in an accident. He had to support his mother by working in a grocery for $1 a week. At age 17, Hill sought his fortune in America and moved to St. Paul, Minnesota. Since he had no margin in his life for failure, his motto was, quote, "Work, do hard work, intelligent work, and then more work." He clerked for a shipping company and learned the transportation business inside out. He studied bookkeeping and mastered the costs for shipping people and merchandise from one place to another. As he was working, he became intrigued with the future of the American Northwest, which was America's last frontier. The five states from Minnesota to Washington made up 1/6 of the nation's land, but it remained undeveloped for many years. The climate was harsh, and the terrain was imposing. There were obvious possibilities with the trees, the coal, and the copper in the region, but crossing it and connecting it with the rest of the nation seemed impossible. The Rocky Mountains divided the area into distinct parts. To the east were Montana, North Dakota, and Minnesota, which were dry, cold, flat, and, predictably, empty. It was part of what pioneers called the Great American Desert. Once the Rockies were crossed, the land in Idaho and Washington turned green with forests and plentiful rain. But the road to the coast was broken by almost uncrossable canyons and jagged peaks of the Cascade Mountains. Since the Northwest was fragmented in geography, remote in location, and harsh in climate, most settlers stopped in the lower Great Plains or went on to California. To most people, the American Northwest was, in the words of General William T. Sherman, quote, "as bad a piece of land as God ever made." But to Hill, the Northwest was an opportunity to develop America's last frontier. Where some saw deserts and mountains, Hill had a vision of farms and cities. But he needed to develop the resources. Hill learned the Northwest firsthand, working on the docks in St. Paul, piloting a steamboat on the Red River, and traveling on snowshoes in North Dakota. Hill's dream was to build a railroad, to develop the region, and then to prosper with it. Hill saw his opportunity in 1878 when he and a group of Canadian friends bought the bankrupt St. Paul and Pacific Railroad from a group of Dutch bondholders. The St. Paul and Pacific story, like that of the Union Pacific, had been one of federal subsidies, stock manipulation, profit-taking on construction, and bankruptcy. Its 10 miles of track were sometimes unconnected and were made of 15 separate patterns of iron. Bridge material, ties, and equipment were scattered along the right-of-way. When Hill and his friends bought this seemingly worthless railroad and announced their intention to complete it, critics dubbed it Hill's Folly. But with his customary work, hard work, and more work, Hill did complete it, ran it profitably, and soon decided to expand it into North Dakota. It was not yet a transcontinental, but it was in the process of becoming one. As Hill built his railroad across the Northwest, he followed a consistent strategy. First, he always built slowly, and he developed the export of the area before he moved further west. In the Great Plains, this export was wheat, and Hill promoted dry farming to increase wheat yields. He advocated diversifying crops, and he imported 7,000 head of cattle from England and elsewhere, handing them over free of charge to settlers near his line. Hill was a pump primer. He knew that if farmers prospered, their freight would give him steady returns every year. The key was to get people to come to the Northwest. To attract immigrants, Hill offered to bring them out to the Northwest for a mere $10 each if they would farm near his railroad. "You are now our children," Hill would tell the immigrants. "But we are in the same boat with you, and we have got to prosper with you, or we have got to be poor with you." To make sure his settlers prospered, he even set up his own experimental farms to test new seed, livestock, and equipment. He promoted crop rotation, mixed farming, and the use of fertilizers. Finally, he sponsored contests and awarded prizes to those who raised meaty livestock or grew abundant wheat. Hill built his railroad for durability and efficiency. "What we want," he said, "is the best possible line, shortest distance, lowest grades, and least curvature that we can build." That meant that Hill personally supervised the surveying and construction. He said, quote, "I find that it pays to be where the money is being spent," end quote. But Hill didn't skimp on quality materials. He believed that building a functional and durable product saved money in the long run. For example, he usually imported high-quality Bessemer rails, even though they cost more than those made in America. He was thinking about the future, and quality building cut costs in the long run. Hill's quest for short routes, low grades, and few curvatures was an obsession. In 1889, Hill conquered the Rocky Mountains by finding the legendary Marias Pass. Lewis and Clark had described a low pass through the Rocky Mountains back in 1805, but later no one seemed to know whether it really existed or, if it did, where it was. Hill wanted the best gradient so much that he hired a man to spend months searching western Montana for this legendary pass. He did, in fact, find it, and the ecstatic Hill shortened his route almost 100 miles because of this. Make no mistake about it, Hill was a colorful entrepreneur, full of energy and curiosity. He could be gruff and confrontational. Once, in anger, he picked up his large desk and threw it out the window. When an official at the Union Pacific tried to use government to block Hill from moving his railroad westward, Hill stormed into the man's office and shouted furiously at him until he surrendered. Yet Hill also became a lifelong reader and a man of culture. He sprinkled his conversation with references to Shakespeare, and Hill was a superb critic and collector of modern art, especially the French Impressionists. But most of all, he knew how to run a railroad and make it profitable for both customers and stockholders. Hill's expertise became clear in the Depression year of 1893. In that desperate year, with money scarce, all the transcontinental owners, except Hill, were lobbying in Congress for more government loans. To one of them, Hill wrote, quote, "The government should not furnish capital to these companies, in addition to their enormous land subsidies, to enable them to conduct their business in competition with enterprises that have received no aid from the public treasury." He proudly concluded, "Our line in the North was built without any government aid, even the right-of-way, through hundreds of miles of public lands, being paid for in cash," end quote. Shortly after Hill wrote this, the Union Pacific, the Northern Pacific, and the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe all went bankrupt and had to be reorganized. This didn't surprise Hill. He gloated, "You will now recall how often it has been said that when the Northern Pacific, the Union Pacific, and other competitors failed, our company would not be able to stand. Now we have them all in bankruptcy while we have gone along and met their competition." Hill criticized the grab for subsidies, But here is the ironic twist. Those who got federal aid ended up being hung by the strings that were attached to it. In other words, there is some cause and effect between Hills having no subsidy and prospering, and the other transcontinentals getting aid and going bankrupt. By building the Great Northern without government aid, for example, Hill could build his line as he saw fit. Before 1890, American rails were inferior to some foreign rails, so Hill bought English and German rails for his Great Northern. The subsidized transcontinentals were required in their charters to buy American-made steel, so they were stuck with the lesser product. Their charters also required them to carry government mail at a discount, and this cut into their earnings. Finally, without congressional approval, the subsidized railroads could not build spur lines off of the main line. Hill's Great Northern, in contrast, looked like an octopus, and he credited spur lines as being critical to his success. The issue of foreign trade is important and was hotly disputed during Congress's debates on the transcontinentals. Advocates of federal aid strongly argued that subsidized railroads would capture foreign trade and increase national wealth. Quote, "Commerce is power and empire," said Senator William Gwin of California. Then he said, "Give us, as this Union Pacific Railroad would, the permanent control of the commerce and exchanges of the world, and in the progress of time and the advance of civilization, we would command the institutions of the world." Yet the Union Pacific was so inefficient, it couldn't even capture or develop the trade of its own region, least of all the world. If Hill hadn't come along and built the privately financed Great Northern, the United States might have lost opportunities to capture world markets forever. Once he completed the Great Northern, he studied the opportunities for trade in China, and he marveled at its potential. Quote, "If the people of a single province of China should consume, instead of rice, an ounce a day of our flour, they would need 50 million bushels of wheat per annum, or twice the Western surplus." The key, he believed, was low freight rates, and these he intended to supply. In 1900, he plowed $6 million into his Great Northern Steamship Company, and he shuttled two steamships back and forth from Seattle to Yokohama and Hong Kong. Selling wheat was only one of Hill's ideas. He tried cotton as well. Ever the prompt-timer, Hill told a group of Japanese industrialists he would send them cheap southern cotton and deliver it free if they would use it along with the short staple variety of cotton that they got from India. Now, if the Japanese didn't like it, they could have a refund and keep the cotton. This technique worked, and Hill filled many boxcars and steamships with southern cotton destined for Japan. Hill's railroads and steamships also carried New England textiles to China. In 1896, American exports to Japan were only $8 million, but 9 years later, with Hill in command, this figure had leaped to $52 million. An even greater coup may have been Hill's capturing of the Japanese rail market. Around 1900, Japan began a railroad boom, and England and Belgium made bids to supply the rails. In this case, the Japanese may have underestimated Hill. It didn't seem likely that he could be competitive if he had to buy rails in Pittsburgh, ship them to the Great Northern, carry them by rail to Seattle, then by steamship to Yokohama. Hill was so efficient, however, and so eager for trade in Asia, that he underbid the English and the Belgians and captured the order for 15,000 tons of rail. Hill was spearheading American dominance in the Orient. Hill worked diligently to market the exports of the Northwest. Wheat from the plains, copper from Montana, and apples from Washington all got Hill's special attention. Without Hill's low freight rates and aggressive marketing, some of these Northwest products might never have been competitive to export. Washington and Oregon, for example, were covered with western pine trees and Douglas fir trees. But it was southern pine that dominated much of the American lumber market. Hill could provide the lowest freight rates, but he needed someone to risk harvesting the western lumber. He found Frederick Weyerhaeuser, his next-door neighbor, and sold him 900,000 acres of western timberland at a mere $6 an acre. Then Hill cut freight costs from 90 to 40 cents per 100 pounds. And the two of them, Hill and Weyerhaeuser, captured some of the Midwestern lumber markets and prospered together. Hill became America's greatest railroad builder, he believed, because he followed a consistent philosophy of business. First, build the most efficient line possible. Second, use this line to promote the exports in your section. In other words, you must help others before you can be helped. Third, do not overextend. Expand only as profits allow. Hill would probably have agreed with Thomas Edison that genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. Few people were willing to exert the perspiration necessary to learn the railroad business and apply these principles. Leaders of other transcontinentals took the easy route and chased subsidies, hiked their rates, manipulated stock, but this approach never built a winning railroad. Hill said, quote, "If the Northern Pacific could be handled as we handle our railroad, it could be made a great property. But it has not been run as a railway for years, but as a device for creating bonds to be sold," end quote. Hill understood markets, prices, and human nature. When he saw what his rivals were doing, he ceased to fear them. What can we learn from this remarkable story of James J. Hill? First and foremost, people make a difference. Your destiny is not determined by accident or fate. Who would have thought that an immigrant boy to America who grew up in poverty, without a father, and with only one eye, would be the colossal railroad builder of the century? Hill's Great Northern Railroad spanned 1,700 miles and he built it with no government subsidy. By contrast, the Union Pacific Railroad, headed first by a distinguished Civil War general, and then later by a descendant of two American presidents, lost millions of dollars in government subsidies and went into bankruptcy. Hill started life in the bottom 10% of wealth holders and ended up in the top 1%. How did he do it? By providing the best railroad in the country at a low price for customers. The life of James J. Hill made a difference to millions of Americans and to millions of people in other countries, from China and Japan to England and Belgium. Hill's story mirrors the success of America's story. In 1838, when Hill was born, America was still a second-rate economic power, way behind England and also behind Prussia and France. By 1916, the year that Hill died, the United States was the world power, the world economic and military power, as the world would see in World War I. James J. Hill and his success were part of America's success and helped to explain how free markets made America a great nation. The story of Hill is chapter 2 of my book, The Myth of the Robber Barons. But I would also like to recommend another book by Albro Martin. It's entitled James J. Hill and the Opening of the American Northwest. Albro Martin is a fine economic historian, and he has enormous detail, very good detail, on the life of James J. Hill. And that concludes today's episode of Books with Burt. Thank you all for listening. Be sure to subscribe and rate my podcast on Spotify, iTunes, or any other place, but only if you want to give it high ratings. If you want to give it low ratings, avoid it. We'll start. And if you like today's episodes and you want to find more content to fill your heart with love for America and conservative ideas, be sure to check out YAF.org. The conservative movement starts here. Until next time, keep reading.